It's me, Scott Phoebe. I'm back after a few weeks of being away, so I hope you've all been well. Very good evening to you. 7 minutes past seven on this rather blustery Monday evening. Tonight, our guests are from Advanced Technology. They consist of Karen Mosley, Susan Moore, Stacey Coburn and Daniel Gammons. I'll introduce them later, and they're going to be talking about some of the initiatives that are going on in the local area as regards cancer. We've got quite a studio for this evening, so can I sort of go around and ask you all to introduce yourself, starting with you, Karen?
I'm Karen, and I'm the lead community cancer nurse for HCCA and Huntingdon Community Cancer Network.
Okay, thank you. Susan?
Yeah, I'm Susan. And I'm a trustee for the Hunts Community Cancer Network charity that works in partnership with the nursing team.
Okay, thank you, Susan. Stacey, far away.
Hi, I'm Stacey. I'm a principal advisor that works at the Eastern Academic Health Science Network.
Okay. Welcome aboard. Welcome, Stacey. Hello, Colin.
Hi there, I'm Colin, and I'm a cancer patient.
Right, okay. And Daniel.
Hi, my name is Daniel Gammons. I'm the Sports Development Officer at Huntingdonshire District Council, looking after people with long-term health conditions.
Okay, thank you. Welcome all. We've got quite a lot to go through, so I've got a list of questions here which we can go through, and you can answer some of the questions. Now, in terms of the national and local incidence of people with a diagnosis of cancer and so on, just tell us a little bit about that and what the prognosis is these days and the predictions for the future. Okay. Can you, Karen?
Yeah, so we know that obviously cancer's on the increase. We know that by 2030 that we're going to have nearly 4 million people living with cancer in the UK.
Is that because people are living longer or...
Yeah,
or is it life? I mean, people's lifestyles tend to be a bit better these days. I don't know.
And we know that one in two of us are going to have cancer at some time. We know that obviously more than four out of the ten cases of cancer can be prevented by lifestyle changes. So, you know, keeping active, maintaining a healthy body weight, not smoking, cutting back on alcohol, staying safe in the sun, and much more. And like you said, it's on the increase, and that's mainly because there's obviously a growing and aging population in the UK, and also as well, people are surviving longer with cancer now and living for much longer with cancer.
I was going to say it's not got sort of the stigma it used to have. I mean, we used to be terrified of the word back in the day, didn't they? But I think nowadays. The treatments have improved significantly over the years, haven't they?
Yeah, no, definitely. There's been a lot more advance in cancer treatments, and so you know we are seeing patients living for much longer now, and it is being viewed much more as a long-term condition now.
Mm. Yeah. Now, what's different about the provision of cancer care through the Hunts Cancer Care Nursing Service then?
Okay, so we're a home-based service, so we're seeing patients from initial diagnosis through to sort of survivorship, but also then patients out there that are sort of living with cancer as well in Huntingdonshire. We're treating them in the community rather than hospitals. We want to try and reduce, obviously, patients having to visit the hospital outpatient appointments, admissions to hospital. That obviously helps the hospital because it saves them money.
Sure.
But also, obviously, benefits the patients and helps them continue that sort of trying to maintain that independent lifestyle, you know, still going to work if they can.
There's a great TV campaign on at the moment, I've noticed, you know, fathers with cancer are still a father and a lover with cancer is still a lover, and so they're quite effective, those adverts, I think.
Yeah. We're based at Hinchinbrook at the Woodland, but we'll see anybody within the Huntingdonshire area, whichever hospital they're being treated at.
Yeah. Now, what sort of activity are we talking about then for cancer patients and how long should this last for?
So, obviously, we're really lucky that we're partnered with the charity and that we're able to, that patients can obviously access a home-based nursing service, but also have access to a physical activity programme as well. So patients that are recovering from or living with cancer in the area can obviously have access to that programme. We know Macmillan's report, The Move More, says that patients are at much greater risk of side effects from their treatment and long-term health problems, or a greater risk of reoccurrence because they're not physically active enough. There was a recent National Institute for Health Research publication that shows cancer survivors, their experience changes to their physical function resulting from cancer and its treatment, therefore restoring that functionality can help maintain patients' independence.
Mm.
And obviously, that is being reinforced by the work that's going on.
Sure.
The Huntingdonshire.
Well, let's talk to Susan about that. Now that you are a trustee of the Hunts Community Cancer Network, just tell us a little about the charity and how did it come about and what basically it does.
Well, what you've got in Huntingdonshire is something that is really special. This the lead nurse at the time started a project along with many other hospitals across East Anglia to improve cancer care for people. And she wanted not only to do what Karen's just described, which is to take that care to people to enable them to keep working, but she wanted to focus as much on what happened to people after intensive treatment ended as she did during the treatment phase. Mm. And when she described it to us, we were a group of people with cancer at the time, we said, we want that. But we also said, because we'd all worked, there is no way the NHS is going to have the funds to enable you to do what you want to do. Mm. So we want it. We'll put our hands in our pockets. And we started the charity then, imagining we'd probably raise about £5,000. And we've been able to grow it. And we're now a registered charity.
Okay. And when was this? When did this start?
Well, I was just looking at it today, and it was only in April of 2014.
Seems
such a long time ago.
Right. And what are the main benefits then for the patients that participate?
Okay. Well, the first thing is we don't call people patients. Because, no, it's not. No, it isn't at all. But it is important.
Right.
Because being diagnosed with cancer... it's devastating, sure. Even though it's probably not considered to be the killer that maybe it once was, but it's still emotionally devastating.
Sure.
And you have to deal with that diagnosis, you have to grit your teeth, you have to get yourself through treatment. And then when the treatment's over and you're ready to say, oh, I want to talk about this, your family perhaps doesn't want you to because they want things to be back to normal.
Mm.
And all the stuff that's around getting yourself back is what you're striving to put back together again then, when perhaps the support isn't what it used to be.
Because normally the support comes through the treatment, let's say, when you're going through the treatment and so on. There's a lot of support then, but afterwards...
It stops.
Yeah, yeah.
It stops, and someone will say...
And that's where you come in.
Yeah, I'll see you in 3 months.
Yeah,
what?
Yeah.
What? I've lived here, and now you'll see me in 3 months.
Yeah.
And what's this I've heard about recurrence, and how do I stay fit? And so the charity began in order to support people through that phase. And of course, it isn't a chop off. The nursing service are continuing to be there to support people as well through that phase.
Yeah.
So we do things that bring people together. We're very interested in evidence-based programs, things that we know can help and that we can measure. So we work in the areas of exercise, emotional well-being, and nutrition.
Yeah.
And what we know is that people able to talk to people about a dreadful experience that they've just had is really valuable. Being able to not to have to apologise for saying I don't feel good, or not having to apologise for just launching into something, but knowing that the people around you will be supportive of you is really important. So all the things that we design enable people to spend time together.
Okay. And do you do any work with sort of the families of your, what's the word that I should use instead of patients?
Well, you can use,
customers,
you use a word.
Friends?
No, people.
People, right.
Because for us, it's a journey from patient to person.
It's difficult in a sort of family situation because the person who's just had the diagnosis obviously doesn't want to upset his loved ones, so they try and sort of put a brave face on, let's say. The loved ones don't necessarily want to talk about it because they want to support the person who's going through the treatment and so on. So it can be almost like a little bit of a standoff, can it, I guess?
And absolutely, and everybody needs to talk.
Yeah.
And what the nursing team will do, and Karen can tell you about this, is one of the things we can offer is counselling. Mm. So everybody's devastated by a cancer diagnosis, but some people can't pull back from it. Mm. So then we can offer them immediate access. We're not trying to replace the other services, but we are trying to provide immediate access for yeah. them. And again, because the nursing team go out into homes, they know the people. They know the people, they know the people's families. Mm. So, and we include partners. They're welcome to yeah. come along to any of the activities that we do.
Now, you mentioned about the importance of keeping fit and looking after yourself and nutrition and so on during your treatment, let's say, and afterwards, during your sort of recovery phase. Just tell us a bit about that. There's a scheme called Get Active, that's
Absolutely.
Right? Just tell us a little bit about that, if
Absolutely
you can.
Right. So Get Active is about people being supported to return to exercise. And it's a programme which was originally designed with the help of a personal trainer, Marion Foreman, who's a fantastic person, and we put the programme together. But then we met Jessica of Aseptica and Kevin, who is out there, and they supported us as well to use technology. So technology enables people to start to take control of themselves, mm. and they can start to monitor themselves. They can know.
Susan has got a wristband on that she was showing me earlier yeah. on, which looks a little bit like one of the Fitbits. I hope I'm allowed to say that. But it's a little bit more clever than that, isn't it, Susan?
Yes, it is, and its real benefit is that it can be monitored.
Yeah.
So the personal trainer, the nursing team, people can look at the activity that's being undertaken and can enable people to be encouraged to do better, but can spot if things aren't going right
yeah.
and to intervene quite quickly to say, how are you doing here?
Yeah.
So initially, with Aseptica's help, we began our program of Get Active, and then that led to other help, which has really enabled us to extend our program.
Okay.
So what we do is we've been running closely monitored programs because, as Karen said, the evidence says that as soon as you can get people back to activity, the better. So if you can get people back to activity during treatment, that's the best time to start.
Mm. Okay.
But the person who is leading them back to activity needs to be monitoring them quite closely. So HCCN do that, and then when we get to that bit, I can tell you about what else we're doing.
All right, fantastic. Susan, we were just talking about before the outbreak there of the Get Active scheme. What about the partnership and any future initiatives that are coming along?
Well, I'm so glad you asked me that.
So am I.
I'm dying to tell you. So we've been running it in-house. So the nurses refer people to us, and then we've been helping them get back to exercise. But we need to reach far more people, and we need to enable people to carry on in exercise until it becomes a fixed habit.
Yeah.
So with the brilliant help from EHSN, Stacey, who will be talking in a minute, who's helped us, enabled us to do wonderful things, and now the help from the Leisure Centre, we're able to enable our patients, people, goodness me, when we no longer need to monitor them so closely, to move out to the Leisure Centre for them to be supported there.
All right. Well, let's talk about that, Daniel, about HDCs and the Leisure Centre's role in this. How do you sort of fit in, so to speak?
So with the initial exercise, they're normally doing something either in the hospital or in a more controlled setting, whereas we're looking more community-based, trying to keep people exercising for longer, hopefully for the rest of their lives.
Mm.
So keeping it as part of their routine, and we do.
I guess
that
you have to tailor it as well, because not everyone's the same, are they? I mean, you've got people of different ages coming in. You have people with different sort of abilities, let's say, in terms of physical abilities. So I guess it's quite a tailored program you have to sort of come up with.
Yeah, absolutely. We at the moment we run similar sort of thing for cardiac rehab. So it is a circuit based exercise, but with a lot of tailoring in it. So each exercise has three different options.
Right.
And there's 10 different exercises.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so you could work out the possibilities that people could do. And then you'll have different people that want to do different things within that as well. So it is getting the right instructors with the right qualifications to be able to prescribe the right exercise for those people as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's very specific because, as you say, people are very different. And certainly with cancer, it gets even more so than with cardiac related conditions. So, yeah.
In what respect?
Well, there's so many more different types.
Varieties of people, I guess.
Types of
and
people.
And ages and so on. Because it can affect someone of any age, I guess.
Yeah, so it's the ages, the cancer site, the conditions, the treatment they've had, whether it's ongoing treatment, whether it's already they've finished treatment and it's then part of living the rest of their lives.
Sure.
Normally with cardiac rehab, it is something we have, they've finished their treatment, they've done their bit, it's very regimented, whereas cancer rehab will be a bit more fluid than that.
Right. Now, in terms of the key behaviours and habits to develop in participants recovering from cancer, can you sort of expand on that a little bit for us?
Yeah, definitely. So we're looking to help improve people's quality of life predominantly. So it's their activity levels, make sure we can increase that or maintain it as much as possible during treatment and increasing afterwards to help with their weight maintenance as well as other physiological measures as well. So with their blood pressure or any blood test scores, just kind of improving their activity levels.
And this is at the One Leisure sites around the area.
So the One Leisure sites operated on behalf of four Hunt District Council.
Yep.
They are the council run facilities throughout the district. So we have these leisure centres in Huntingdon, St Ives, St Neots, Sawtrey and Ramsey, but specifically we're looking at Huntingdon at the moment with regard to the cancer.
And are these classes then that occur on specific times and days of the week?
So the cancer classes haven't started yet.
Right.
They will be starting in the new year. I think we're looking at the moment starting in February, so they're not far away.
Right.
And so we've got more people who are qualified to teach those as well. And so we're looking at progressing that as soon as possible, but it's unfortunately.
And what kind of thing can people expect of you? I mean, I know you're putting the programme together, it's not been launched yet, but what can people expect when they turn up?
A friendly face, to begin with.
Yeah.
but also someone who understands their conditions with regard to the instructors, but then it's the group as well.
Mm.
It's that social dynamic of people who are in a similar situation.
Yeah.
What I often say about my cardiac classes is that people come to be sociable, the exercise is a byproduct.
Yeah.
So what better place to be to have that social interaction? The same thing with cancer, you'll build that community, and that's what we want to achieve with this, is to get people together of a similar mindset to help each other through that pathway as well.
Yeah. And what about sort of referrals? How do cancer patients get referred to this this class, so to speak?
So it'll be either through a formal the referrals from a health professional through the HCCN, or they can either contact us for initial interest, but then we'll need information from a registered health professional to get the right information to make sure that we've got all that, so that we can make sure we're giving the best advice for what they should be doing.
Yeah. Okay. So these classes starting in February, you say.
Yeah.
There's websites, I'm guessing, and so on that people can go on to get updates in terms of.
I'm from the Active Lifestyles team as part of HDC. So, yeah, there's contact numbers and email addresses on online that people can contact to register their interest, or they can speak to anyone from the HDCN who'll be able to point them in the right direction.
Yeah.
And so then when the classes do start up, if people are interested and they've hopefully registered their interest, we'll contact them and let them know the details as and when we know as well.
Okay, brilliant. Well, let's move on to Stacey. Hello, Stacey.
Hello.
How you doing?
Good, thank you. How are you?
No, I'm very well. Good to see you. Now, you are, let's have a look, you are the Principal Advisor for the Eastern Academic Health Science Network.
I am.
Eastern ASHN. Just tell us a little bit about that and what your role is in this partnership.
Okay. So the Eastern AHSN operates as one of 15 national organisations. So we operate as a network, but we are regionally based. So we cover six counties, so Bedfordshire, Cambridgeshire, Norfolk, Suffolk, bits of Hertfordshire and bits of Essex as well. And we were set up and we're commissioned by NHS England, as well as others, to support the adoption of innovation within our region. And we do, we have two areas of focus. So firstly, obviously, adopting innovation to support patient experience, patient outcomes or population, well, health and well-being generally. And the second aspect is then working with local innovators as well, which is why we're really interested in this particular partnership, to support them to access and get their innovations into health and care to really improve the service that we can provide for the local population. So as a team, so I work for the transformation support team within the AHSN, and we work with all of the local health and care providers and commissioners to help them think about how they can adopt innovation to deliver their strategies. So we're very much about supporting them to achieve what they have already set out to do. And one of those obviously really interesting projects for us is the partnership here between Hinchinbrook, HCCN, HDC, and a local innovator who's also based in the region. So that's so that's where we come in.
And when you talk about innovation, it's technology. It can be technology, but it could also be sort of just practice, if you like.
Yeah, it's a mix of technology. It's also best practice, pathway improvement. So it's a real mix. And I think what's particularly interesting about this project is that it does combine the technology, the digital element, which is really interesting, particularly because you've got almost the clinical indications. So the nursing teams and the clinical teams and the health professionals can look at the data and they can support people quite actively, proactively, rather than waiting until something goes wrong. But there's also, I think, as you know, Susan and Dan have talked about, the social element, the peer support element is really, really important. So I think that combined with the education, combined with the technology, gives us a really interesting project in this particular area. And it is, I suppose, accessible and replicable across many, many different condition areas. So, you know, we're already doing it in cardiac, we're doing it in cancer, and in other areas of the country, they're looking at pulmonary rehab as well. So it's got massive opportunity for adoption across many, many long-term conditions. And in a world where the health and care services are particularly challenged, this type of innovation is really important because it gives us the best outcomes for a really, you know, good, valuable, efficient way of spending our money.
And this is something new. I mean, you know, this kind of initiative. Why hasn't it been done years ago?
I don't think it's entirely new. I think many people have tried and there are existing programs, but I think what's really interesting here, and we talk about it a lot in health and care, is the integration. So it is that working across providers, and quite often what the, I suppose, the system and the structure doesn't allow us to do is to make the finances flow properly and to help the kind of organisations work collaboratively. But actually what we found here is because it's very homegrown, because people are working together because they want to and because it's the right thing to do for the person, it just works. So I think from our perspective, you know, the support that we can provide.
And this is financial support as well through Eastern AHS.
Yes, it is. Yeah, so we've provided some support to automate some of the data at the back end of the system to actually make it much easier for the nursing team to understand what the data is telling them. So just to reduce the amount of time they have to spend interpreting it, which means they can spend more time out with the patients and with those that are participating in the programme. So that's really important. You know, if we can be more efficient, if we can be more productive with their time, hopefully we can see, you know, and support more people through that. So we've funded that bit of development. And in addition, I think we've funded and supported the training of the additional personal trainers that will undertake the cancer classes from February
of next year. And how have you noticed the difference, Karen? Because you're seeing this data, I'm guessing. You're getting this data feedback, if you like, and how do you
well,
handle
that? We definitely see it's a benefit to patients, and we definitely see that the patients that are sort of being part of the program during their treatment, we really notice that their treatment and then their recovery afterwards seems to be so much quicker and, you know, and better for them than people that are maybe not, you know, keeping so active.
And as Susan says, that is evidence-based. You want stuff to... And what about nutrition? You mentioned nutrition earlier on. How does that fit into the scheme of things? Because it's very much more important these days, I think, Susan, isn't it? People are more aware of nutrition and how important it can be.
Absolutely. And another wonderful part of this, which we haven't talked about, is that this same band, this same app, can be used to enable people to monitor their weight. So some people, after a diagnosis of cancer, may lose weight and some may put weight on. Mm. Either way, people aren't happy with that and want to get back to a norm. So the personal trainer that we work with is also skilled in nutrition, and so they're able to work with her on their nutrition and their diet as well. Of course, we might sound like a charity that only offers a Get Active process, but of course we offer a whole load of other things. And one of the other things we do are twice yearly conferences. So what we'll do is bring people in to speak to people to give them unbiased information about food.
Yeah.
What food contains, what foods are useful, what foods are not so useful. But there's no hype, there's no diets. It's to enable people to make their own decision about how to manage their nutrition.
Mm. Yeah, no, it's interesting. And where do these take place?
Oh, well, they take place at Huntingdon Racecourse.
Yep.
In their conference suite. We run them in April and November.
Right.
And the next one will be on November the 7th. They're open to all people who are cared for by HCCN or by people who have found their way to HCCN, the charity, because there are some people who get their treatment way outside of Huntingdonshire. But if they want to come along, they're welcome, and they're very welcome to bring someone with them.
Okay.
And the way we structure the day is to make sure that there is plenty of time for questions, plenty of time for thinking about what they've been told, and plenty of time for taking notes so that they can follow things up afterwards.
Yeah, okay. Wonderful. And there's a website. I'm assuming you have
www.hccn.org.uk.
Wonderful. So if people want to find out a bit more,
it's
they can go onto the website.
They certainly can.
Finally, Karen's had to shoot off because she had to move her car. But Colin Alder. Now, Colin, the proof's in the pudding, I suppose. So you're on the other end of it. You're the recipient, of these initiatives.
Yeah. I guess I'm the end user. Probably.
The guinea pig, the punter. So just tell us your experience and how it's helped you.
Sure.
And a little bit maybe about how you came to speak to these guys in the first place.
Yeah. Well, I mean, immediately following a diagnosis for an incurable form of cancer, I was fortunate to be summoned into the HCCN family in a kind of way. It feels like a family.
Yeah.
It's quite a very supportive organisation. And when you're diagnosed with this type of thing, you immediately feel slightly lonely and very concerned about life. And it's only you and nobody else has got any experience. And meeting other people and sharing their experiences is very uplifting, actually, and very, 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 very reassuring.
Yeah.
In the sense that they lead you through a complex world which is new to you.
And sure.
The world of cancer is not one most people want to embark upon. I mean, my primary involvement initially was in the Keep Active scheme, because I've always been a fit person. I walk a great deal. I trekked in the Himalayas and all that kind of stuff until I got this, and will do again. And so the Keep Active scheme naturally attracted my interest as a focal point of support. So I joined this through the circuit training organisation, which currently takes place at Hinchingbrook, but will ultimately be in the
this is something that Danny was talking about
exactly,
earlier on.
That's
yeah,
what he's been talking about. And the classes are run by an amazing lady called Marion Foreman, who trains, motivates patients of varying levels of fitness and stages of their cancer journey in that sense. But for me, joining this class was a real kickstart, which I personally needed. I was wallowing a little bit, feeling very, very sorry for myself, and it was a kickstart. And so it forced me, if you like, to re-enter the real world and begin to enjoy a more or less normal life. It provided not only much needed physical exercise, but also the comradeship. I mean, this is an important thing for me, the comradeship of a great bunch of mutually supportive people who, more importantly, all understand what it is to have experienced cancer. So there's no need for language. We all know where we're coming from.
Yeah. I guess that's the problem sometimes when you're sort of trying to talk to family members. They don't know what you're talking about half the time. So.
Until you've got it, you don't
get it. That's right, exactly.
It's quite honestly the thing.
Yeah.
So having been involved with the Get Active scheme for well over a year now, I have had many benefits from it, which are some of which I've alluded to there. But the impact of a diagnosis of this type on you damaged my confidence and my total self-esteem, which wasn't something I was pretty used to, quite frankly. You know, I was used to be able to look after myself and be there.
I can imagine it just knocked you for six.
But it did indeed. But that's gone. I'm fine. That, through HCCN, I'm restored to my former glory, if you like, in that sort of sense. And I walk regularly. I walk with my dog 6 or 7 miles a day. I also walk with two local walking
groups. You got one of the fittest dogs in the county, I think.
One of the fittest dogs. Well, they are, yes. I've also rejoined a gym, which I go to work on my cardiovascular function and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, if you like, whilst my medical condition still remains incurable, I now live a life to the full. And this is thanks in the main. You know, I'm very pro HCCN. They've been a bit of a lifesaver for me, which I hope I'm communicating in the kind of way.
Well, absolutely.
And my greatest hope, in a way, is that this wonderful concept, and it's broadening all the time. You know, with the technology, with the gym, local gymnasiums, and the leisure industry. I just hope we're able to see it spread broadly in the UK, so that others can benefit in the same way that indeed I have.
Well, that's very hats off to you, Colin. It sounds as though it's really made a difference to you.
A great difference.
And we wish you all the best for the future. That's Stacey just taking up Colin's point there. You know, let's hope this works well. And there's a lot of evidence. Colin was quite moving in terms of how he spoke about it. If this works, then you know it would be great to sort of roll out, as Colin's mentioned.
It would. And one of the things that we're working with HCCN and HDC on actually is trying to really measure the impact on people. Mm. So there's a measure called the patient activation measure, which looks at the skills and the knowledge and the confidence of people to manage their own condition, to actually get back to the position that kind of Colin's raised, you know, in terms of having self-esteem and confidence and understanding what the diagnosis means to them and what the limitations are and what they're not. Mm. So we are supporting both HCCN and HDC to implement this measure. It's a national recognised tool. It's developed in the States, but it's being used quite widely now in the NHS and within England. And what it helps us to do is build an evidence base that we can actually go to other areas and we can say this is what it means for people and this is the impact that it can have on the individual, because that's the most important thing out of this. But also from a health and care system perspective, people who are activated, people who have the knowledge and the skills to manage their conditions, use less services. Mm. So from a, you know, efficiency point
kind of
view,
funds it. Yeah, I understand. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we can create space and capacity to run more of these types of classes and keep people well at home and in the community, rather than having to go into hospital when they don't really need to. So it's a kind of self-fulfilling cycle. If we can get this right and we can get this adopted in a number of areas, we can both make people's lives better, but also reduce the kind of strain on the health system and care system as it is currently.
It's a fantastic initiative. Please do, Susan, yeah.
I echo everything that Stacey said, and we just want to pick up what it feels like for people.
Yeah.
It's really hard having cancer, and it's really hard when you not only have cancer, but you have other things that are linked to it, and you're working between consultants. It's very difficult to feel in control.
Mm.
And this coaching tool will enable the nursing team to work with people to look at the areas where perhaps they're not as in control as they would like to be, and then in a very practical way to support them to feel more in control, because I want to be in the centre of my healthcare.
Yeah.
I don't want people making decisions about me. I want to be in the middle.
Mm.
And the more enabled I am through processes like this, the better able I am to do that, and the better I feel about that.
Yeah, absolutely. You've all spoken very eloquently, Susan. Thank you very much, Stacey, Colin. We wish you all the best for the future, and Daniel, and Karen, who's moving a car. Thank you all so much for coming in. It's been very, very enlightening and interesting. We could have gone on for another hour, I think, but unfortunately we've run out of time. But thanks again all for coming in. Thank you.
Thank you.